of safety for the vaccines, that inoculating people quickly and therefore dropping the landscape of available victims for the pathogen to a very low number, so that herd immunity drives it to extinction, requires us all to take our share of the risk, and that that because driving it to extinction should be our highest priority, that really people shouldn't think too much about the various nuances, because overwhelmingly fewer people will die if the population is vaccinated from the vaccine than will die from COVID if they're not vaccinated.
And with the vaccine as it currently is being deployed, that is a quite a likely scenario that everything, you know, the virus will fade away in the following sense, that the probability that a more dangerous strain will be created is non-zero, but it's not 50%. It's something smaller. And so maybe you disagree with that, but the scenario we're most likely to see, now that the vaccine is here, is that the effects of the virus will fade away.
First of all, I don't believe that the probability of creating a worse pandemic is low enough to discount. I think the probability is fairly high, and frankly, we are seeing a wave of variants that we will have to do a careful analysis to figure out what exactly that has to do with campaigns of vaccination, where they have been, where they haven't been, where the variants emerged from. But I believe that what we are seeing is a disturbing pattern that reflects that those who were advising caution may well have been right.
The data here, by the way, and a small tangent, is terrible.
Terrible. Right. And why is it terrible is another question, right?
This is where I start getting angry.
Yes.
It's like, there's an obvious opportunity for exceptionally good data, for exceptionally rigorous, like even the website for self-reporting side effects for, not side effects, but negative effects. Adverse events, sorry, for the vaccine. Like, there's many things I could say from both the study perspective, but mostly let me just put on my hat of like HTML and like web design. Like, it's like the worst website. It makes it so unpleasant to report. It makes it so unclear what you're reporting. If somebody actually has serious effects, like if you have very mild effects, what are the incentives for you to even use that crappy website with many pages and forms that don't make any sense? If you have adverse effects, what are the incentives for you to use that website? What is the trust that you have that this information will be used well? All those kinds of things. And the data about who's getting vaccinated, anonymized data about who's getting vaccinated, where, when, with what vaccine, coupled with the adverse effects, all of that we should be collecting. Instead, we're completely not. And we're doing it in a crappy way and using that crappy data to make conclusions that you then twist. You're basically collecting in a way that can arrive at whatever conclusions you want. And the data is being collected by the institutions, by governments. And so therefore, it's obviously they're going to try to construct any kind of narratives they want based on this crappy data. It reminds me of much of psychology, the field that I love, but is flawed in many fundamental ways. So rant over, but coupled with the dangers that you're speaking to, we don't have even the data to understand the dangers.
Yeah, I'm going to pick up on your rant and say estimates of the degree of underreporting in VAERS are that it is 10% of the real to 100%.
And that's the 1%. System for reporting.
Yeah, the VAERS system is is the system for reporting adverse events. So in the U.S., we have above 5,000 unexpected deaths that seem in time to be associated with vaccination. That is an undercount, almost certainly, and by a large factor. We don't know how large. I've seen estimates, 25,000 dead in the U.S. alone. Now, you can make the argument that, okay, that's a large number, but the necessity of immunizing the population to drive SARS-CoV-2 to extinction is such that it's an acceptable number. But I would point out that that actually does not make any sense. And the reason it doesn't make any sense is, actually, there are several reasons. One, if that was really your point, that yes, many, many people are going to die, but many more will die if we don't do this. Were that your approach, you would not be inoculating people who had had COVID-19, which is a large population. There is no reason to expose those people to danger. Their risk of adverse events in the case that they have them is greater. So there's no reason that we would be allowing those people to face a risk of death if this was really about an acceptable number of deaths arising out of this the set of vaccines. I would also point out there's something incredibly bizarre, and I struggle to find language that is strong enough for the horror of vaccinating children in this case, because children suffer a greater risk of long-term effects because they are going to live longer and because this is earlier in their development. Therefore, it impacts systems that are still forming. They tolerate COVID well, and so the benefit to them is very small. And so the only argument for doing this is that they may cryptically be carrying more COVID than we think, and therefore they may be integral to the way the virus spreads through the population. But if that's the reason that we are inoculating children, and there has been some revision in the last day or two about the recommendation on this because of the adverse events that have shown up in children, but to the extent that we were vaccinating children, we were doing it to protect old, infirm people who are the most likely to succumb to COVID-19. What society puts children in danger, robs children of life to save old, infirm people? That's upside down. So there's something about the way we are going about vaccinating, who we are vaccinating, what dangers we are pretending don't exist, that suggests that to some set of people, vaccinating people is a good in and of itself. That is the objective of the exercise, not herd immunity. And the last thing, and I'm sorry, I don't want to prevent you from jumping in here, but the second reason, in addition to the fact that we're exposing people to danger that we should not be exposing them to.
By the way, as a tiny tangent, another huge part of this soup that should have been part of it, that's an incredible solution, is large-scale testing.
Mm-hmm.
But that might be another couple hour conversation, but there's these solutions that are obvious that were available from the very beginning. So you could argue that ivermectin is not that obvious, but maybe the whole point is you have aggressive, very fast research that leads to a meta-analysis and then large-scale production and deployment. Okay, at least that possibility should be seriously considered. Coupled with a serious consideration of large-scale deployment of testing, at-home testing, that could have accelerated the speed at which we reach that herd immunity. But I don't even want to...
Well, let me just say, I am also completely shocked that we did not get on high-quality testing early and that we are still suffering from this even now. Because just the simple ability to track where the virus moves between people would tell us a lot about its mode of transmission, which would allow us to protect ourselves better. Instead, that information was hard won and for no good reason. So I also find this mysterious.
You've spoken with